Okay, good morning to everybody, and thank you to Elijah for this nice introduction, and to all the organizers for inviting me to give this block course on actions. So it's a pleasure for me to be in Arcetri, because this is, as you know, the real hill of Galileo, and this is interesting to talk about astroparticle physics here, because, in a certain way, Galileo was also the founder of astroparticle physics, and one of his sentences that I like is that things are united by invisible bonds. You can't pick a flower without upsetting a star. That is somehow the spirit of the lecture that I will try to convey you. So even if you have elusive particles like the axion that are very weakly interactions, you can have a strong impact on evolution of astrophysical object like the stars. Before starting, just to understand the level, who already knows something about axions? Okay. Also you. Okay. The plan of my lectures will be divided in different topics, and I put also some main reference for each of these topics. And of course, if you need some more specific input, we can discuss during our discussion time, or we will have plenty of time in this week. In particular, I will start today with the theory of axions. So we start really from the basics about the so-called strong CP problem, and how we introduce the axion. And I will follow mostly the treatment given by Peche, who was somehow the father, as you will see, of axions. And during the development of this lecture, we will see that axions introduced for a purely theoretical motivation of particle physics have been rediscovered more recently, because it has been realized that they can play an important role as dark matter candidates. So another set of lectures will be devoted to axion cosmology, so how we can produce axions in the early universe and how axion can act as dark matter. And then I will move to astrophysics, so how we can use stars to probe axions. And of course, I will, when necessary, I will also try to give some idea of how we can search in laboratory axions, so the experiment. So this is some of the plans and some of the few references that I will use. So in order to start today, I want to start really from the basics. So of course, axions emerge in quantum field theory. But before this, let's go a bit earlier. So let's talk about instantons. In quantum mechanics. And let's consider a problem in which you have a potential of this type with A greater than zero, that, as you know, has this double well. Shape. Let's consider at first this problem, the motion of a particle in this potential in classical mechanics. So you know that in classical mechanics you have the vacuum states. There are two vacua that correspond to x equal plus or minus a, where if the momentum is zero, the particle is stuck here. So these are the ground state. So in classical mechanics, you have that minimum energy that is called the vacuum is degenerate. Okay. Let's move now to quantum mechanics. What happens in quantum mechanics? As you know, there is the uncertainty principle, so you cannot measure simultaneously position and momentum of your particle. So what happens is that due to this uncertainty principle, the vacuum state in quantum mechanics has the degeneracy is broken. Because what happens is that even if you put a particle at minimum of energy here, you have the possibility of quantum tunneling, and so the real vacuum in quantum mechanics is a superposition of these two vacua. So in quantum mechanics you have spontaneous, classical mechanics you have spontaneous symmetry breaking, in quantum mechanics you have tunneling. Let's try to solve this problem in quantum mechanics, and let's assume a semi-classical approximation. So in semi-classical approximation, you can assume the states of your system to be sort of localized, for example, Gaussian function, peaked around this minima. And you can indicate with minus A or plus A the state of vacua around the minima. And what you want to calculate is the tunnel effect between these two vacua. If we assume at zero order that there is no tunnel, the Hamiltonian of your system is diagonal and can be written in this way, since the vacua are degenerate. Now, in order to mimic the tunnel effect, you can assume that there is an off-diagonal term. So since you can put, as you know, global energy, so a common phase arbitrarily, we can set the diagonal part of the Hamiltonian equal to zero, so we set the ground state at zero energy, and we put in the off-diagonal part a delta. So this quantity is the one that allows for swaps, for transition from one vacuum to the other one. And so when you diagonalize this Hamiltonian, you obtain that the energy eigen states are these ones. So let's assume that this delta parameter is smaller than zero. And so the ground state would be at E equal delta, and the corresponding ket well, the other states is characterized now. In order to estimate the transition, the tunnel amplitude, we can use as you know, the propagator. And we can switch to imaginary time, so perform what is called a Vick rotation, in order to have this propagator. And you can write the amplitude of a tunnel from minus A and plus A, so from the two states, as that if this amplitude is small, can be expanded. And to estimate this quantity, we can use a semi-classical approximation that allow you to expand this term, as I will show in a second, as e to the minus the classical action divided by h bar. How we get the semi-classical approximation? In general, if you want to calculate the amplitude of transition to a final state at final time T with starting from an initial state in a state given quai, this is the propagator. And this can be written using the path integral prescription as integral over all the possible path of the particle of e to I s. So this is the path integral. I don't know if you are familiar with this language. And this can be expanded using a semi-classical approximation as where we have taken the classical path of the particle. We evaluated the action over the classical path. So how we do this? We can write that E I to the times the classical action is given by I integral minus t over t half plus dt of the Lagrangian. So this is the definition of the action. Now we perform the Vick rotation in order to avoid oscillatory integral. And so we get plus integral d tau of L q q bar. And now the Lagrangian that is in this integral, as you know, is for a particle m over 2 the q in the t square minus v of q. If we use the imaginary time, this becomes minus m over 2 the q in the tau square minus v of q. And so we can call the classical action that is called also Euclidean action because we have changed the time into the imaginary one as minus d in dt 1/2 the q in dt square plus v of q. So what you see is that when we pass to imaginary time, we change the sign of the potential. So we have to work with an inverted potential. Okay? So this is called, this one inside, the Euclidean Lagrangian. That is, contrary to the usual Lagrangian, the sum of the kinetic plus potential energy with inverted potential. Okay? Now what happens is that if we want to calculate the tunnel effect, that is our problem, using this semi-classical approximation, we have to consider the motion, the classical trajectory of the particle, but in an inverted potential, because we have to change the sign. So the potential will be v prime of x, that is minus v of x. So why in classical mechanics, you know, we cannot have tunnel, but using the semi-classical approximation, we don't have to study a tunnel effect. We have to study the motion of a particle that starts from minus A at minus T over 2 and arrives at plus A at T over 2, okay? And so the let's study this, and so we can call xc of t the trajectory of this particle. Now, we can assume the conservation of energy. So if the Lagrangian law is the plus sign of kinetic and potential energy, when you go in semi-classical approximation, the total energy will have a minus sign in the middle. And so you have to consider that the total energy is m over 2 dx in the tau square minus b of x. So we can integrate now this equation, and we get integral between x1 and x2 of square root of m in the x divided 2a plus b of x. And this is equal to integral between t1 and t2 of the tau. So I separated the variables, okay? We can fix the vacuum energy at E equals zero, that is conserved because of conservation of energy. And so we can and insert now in this integral the form of the potential that we are studying, this double well potential. And so the integral now becomes m over 2 alpha square minus a plus a dx square minus square equal integral in the tau. Now the problem is solved. Now it's just mathematics. It's just doing the integral. So, or you remember how to do, or you use mathematics, whatever you prefer, and you get the solution. What we get is that the x function of time is a hyperbolic tangent of 2 over m alpha a tau. Now, if you plot this solution in function of tau, you get something like this. That is the trajectory of a particle that starts from minus a at t equal minus infinity and reaches plus a at t equal plus infinity. And this solution is what Toft called an instanton. So how can you imagine this? You see, the solution is flat except in a region around the turning point that of course you can shift wherever you want in this axis, and around the turning point it jumps quickly from minus a to plus a. This is why this is called the instanton. And this is analogous, I don't know if you have familiarity, of when you look at the quantum field theory solution of a soliton. This is in time, while the soliton is in space, for someone who has already some familiarity with this language. But in any case, this is what is called an instanton. So you see the jump, the tunnel effect, with the classical approximation is seen in this way. And now, if we want to calculate the tunnel amplitude, we have to consider the action. In the Euclidean sense of the plus sign. And so using that total E is zero, T is equal to V. So this can be written as in this way. And that this can be written using that this p square over 2m integral of p dx that is integral between minus a and plus a over 2m v of x in the x. And so now the tunnel amplitude is proportional to the exp of minus 1 over h bar integral so this transition, this instanton transition correspond to what? To finite action in Euclidean space. So what is important is to have a finite action solution. Well, when you study soliton, you have finite energy solution. Here you impose finite action solution in order to have a convergent integral. And so the amplitude can be written as t over h bar exp minus 1 over h bar, the classical amplitude. And from the equation that we wrote at the beginning, we get that the delta, that was the amplitude of transition, is proportional t over h bar . So this is the problem of quantum mechanics, the solution of the problem of quantum mechanics. Okay, it's clear for everybody? Let's still remain in quantum mechanics. And another concept that I want to introduce that is useful for our development is the concept of spontaneous symmetry breaking. I suppose that most of you already have this concept. And the idea in quantum mechanics for spontaneous symmetry breaking is the following. So it exists a symmetry group. Under which the Hamiltonian is symmetric, but the vacuum is not symmetric. Okay? So this is the concept of a spontaneous symmetry breaking. In quantum mechanics, you can have two different cases. The first case, for example, considering this potential, since this is the classical case of spontaneous symmetry breaking. So we have two minima, which have the same vacuum energy and are separate. So there are two possibilities in quantum mechanics. The first is that we have, between these two minima, an infinite potential barrier. In this case, if these minima are separated by an infinite potential bar, you can have spontaneous symmetry breaking. If your particle is in a vacuum, it cannot have a tunnel to the other one because it's separated by this infinite barrier, okay? The other case is that instead, like in our example, the two vacuum are separated by finite barrier. In this case, you don't have spontaneous symmetry breaking in quantum mechanics because you have tunnel effect. So the tunnel effect means that the symmetry is restored. The real vacuum is the superposition of the two vacua. Okay. An example that will be useful also for the following is a potential of this time. Of this type. V of x equal 1 minus cos 2 pi of x, that is a potential. Is a periodic potential in a space, and the minima can be labeled with the natural number x equal plus or minus n. If we consider now which is the symmetry in this case, the potential is invariant under a translation symmetry. Okay, so you can introduce an operator that we call T that maps a minimum into x plus 1. So this is the problem is translation invariant. And now if we assume Gaussian wave packet K localized around this minima, x equal K, we can have that the operator T acts on this ket giving K plus 1. And it commutes, of course, with the Hamiltonian, because this is a symmetry of your Hamiltonian. This is the conservation law of quantum mechanics, okay? So in this case, only classically we have spontaneous symmetry breaking. In quantum mechanics, you have the tunnel between this vacuum. And so we can build what we call a T invariant vacuum that is given by the superposition of the different minima because of the translation invariance, okay? This is used, for example, in solid states. Now let's consider the Hamiltonian which is built in this way. Delta for B is larger than zero. And we assume a periodic boundary condition. So the state one is equal to n plus one. So can you read this Hamiltonian? So can you understand what this Hamiltonian is doing? Or have you seen already? What does the first term? Exactly, so this is the diagonal part of the Hamiltonian. So is the H0. So if the system is free, you have in each node, so you can imagine a lattice. So for example, you can imagine electron on a lattice, okay? Is the energy of the electron in each node, H0. H1, which is the effect? So this is N plus one, minus one. What is the effect of this? So what does, if you have an electron here? Exactly. So it's called in a solid state hopping Hamiltonian. So it allows you to have this hop, this jump to the neighbors from n to n plus one. You see, it's the tunnel in what is called the tight binding approximation. So you can jump only to your neighbor. Okay, it's clear this Hamiltonian for everybody. Okay. Now this problem is a translation invariant. And H commutes with the T. Now, if we consider wave packets localized around each of these sites of the lattice, H1 allows, as you said, to jump to the neighbors. Indeed, if we consider H to the state N, it gives H0 N minus delta N minus 1 minus delta N plus 1. So H1 models the tunnels. Now, we can build, in this case, the state that we call theta And what you can show, starting from this state, is that theta is an eigenstate of T with eigenvalue e to the minus I theta. Then T to the power of n is 1. 3, the values of theta are equal to 2 pi k over n. And 4, theta is also, of course, since T and H commute, theta is also eigenstate of H. And the energy is given by equal 0 minus 2 delta cos theta. And when you consider since theta is given by this, is equal 0 minus 2 delta over n. And if you go at large n, what you obtain is a band of energy between equal 0 minus 2 delta and equal 0 equal 2 delta. That is called in a solid state the Brillouin zone, as you probably know. And this state that we built, and please keep in mind because we will use this, what is called in solid state the Bloch wave state. Okay? So this is a pure quantum mechanics problem. So what we understand is that if you have the possibility, you have an Hamiltonian with a Hopf term that allows you to jump from one neighbor to the other one, the state, the vacuum, is obtained in this way. So the true vacuum is a superposition of this end state, and there is this theta term that is a parameter that enter your solution. Okay. Brillouin zone is the zone, the level energy. If you study solid state electron in conduction zone, you find these bands. Okay, so let's recap what we get till now. So we have classical mechanics, we have spontaneous symmetry breaking. You have the minimum, if you have a potential which has a symmetry, you have the minimum, so the particle is stuck. In quantum mechanics, if you have a finite barrier, you have tunnel, so you don't have spontaneous symmetry breaking, but you have the tunnel between the minima. What happens in quantum field theory? So let's consider the potential that we studied at beginning. But now what happens is that instead of having this in quantum mechanics, so V of Q and Q, here we have V of phi and the phi. For example, you have a Lagrangian. Lambda phi of the four. So what happens in quantum mechanics? In quantum field theory. Can you have a tunnel effect? No, why? Will be possible or impossible? This is a field theory, so this is a field. In quantum mechanics, there is Q and there is V of Q. And in quantum mechanics, we have seen there is tunnel. In quantum field theory, can you have tunnel? Why not? Can you? Mm-hmm. And so, which is physically the problem? Exactly. So this is the solution. So why we don't have a tunnel in quantum mechanics? Because if you want to jump from here to here, in principle you can do the same. This is classical the quantum mechanics, but here you have this integral that gives infinity, as you said. So you have infinite barrier when you have infinite degree of freedom. So you cannot have, that's why when you study quantum field theory, you have symmetry, you have spontaneous symmetry breaking, and the field is stuck in the vacuum. You cannot have tunnel between the vacua. And so why we study tunnel in quantum mechanics? So if it seems that is impossible now, and so probably it's not so interesting, because there is a sort of a loophole. Loophole is constituted by what are called gauge theory. So what we will see in gauge theory is that you have a lot of degree of freedoms that you can wrap about. And so you can create different vacua that are characterized, as we will see, by what is called the topological winding number. And what happens is that you can have a tunnel between this this vacuum that you create in gauge field theory that does not require the jump, the passage to an infinite barrier of potential. So in gauge theory is possible, and now is the topic that I want to explain, to have a tunnel. And we will see that due to the tunnel effect, the true vacuum that we will build will be a superposition of the different gauge vacua that will resemble something like the block wave that you got in this solid state exercise, okay? So this is the plan now. So the plan now is to study instantons. In 3 plus 1, 3 is space and 1 is time, 3 plus 1 dimension. As you understood, as we did in quantum mechanics, we will work in Euclidean space. And so what we will search, as we understood from a Toft definition, we are looking for finite action configuration. And we will study pure Young-Mills theory for some gauge group. So the action for a Young-Mills theory is defined in this way. Where these fields are defined, these are the components of the fields as the mu where we have that this fields component can be written as the components of the fields on the generator of the group, and typically what you get is that the this structure constant FABC are given by this commutation of the generation, and the trace is given if I'm considering, for example, SU3 as a gauge group. SU2 is the same. Except that you have the Pauli matrices as the generators of the groups, and you can write the action using using the fields. So this is our Lagrangian. Do you already know something about Young Mills theory? Okay. In any case, this is what we need. It's just this definition for the action. And it's called the non-abelian because you see we have interactions among the fields here. In the, if you go in U1, so in a abelian electromagnetic, for example, you don't have a self-interaction because they commute. Okay, so let's work in the while or temporal gauge, where we assume that A0 is equal to 0. And our fields reduce to the 0 AI, there is no A0, so, and the Lagrangian is 1/2 the 0 AI square minus the space part FIJA, and this is in analogy with electromagnetism. The difference of E square minus B square. Now, if we consider omega that is a gauge transformation, the action of a gauge transformation on A mu is the following. Okay, by definition of a gauge transformation. So if we want to remain in a temporal gauge where still the time component of the field is zero, we have to impose that, of course, the time derivative of the transformation is zero. And so this implies that omega of x and t is omega x. Now, the Hamiltonian of your theory is the 3x AI the 0 I minus L, and it is 1/2 the 3x EI square plus BA square. Now the gauge transformation, since it's a symmetry of the theory, should commute with the Hamiltonian. And so you can diagonalize both the operators simultaneously. So you will get that there are common eigenstates for the Hamiltonian and for the gauge transformation. Okay. Now, if we want that our gauge transformation comes from an infinitesimal transformation, we should have that omega of x is equal to identity plus I epsilon lambda x. But now the only possibility in order not to break the Lorentz invariance is that lambda of x applied to psi, so this should give in general the eigenvalue lambda. So in order not to break the Lorentz invariance, the only possibility is that you have to impose that lambda x is equal to zero. However, now what is the key point for our following discussion is that this is not the most generic transformation that you can imagine. So not all the gauge transformations are associated to infinitesimal transformation. How can we see this? An example is from, let's say, geometry, is when you define the stereographic projection. So how is defined the stereographic projection? You have a map that maps a sphere on a plane. And so you map a sphere, spherical surface, on what? On the plane, and the poles goes to infinity, so the plane to infinity. And this is isomorphic to S3. So the stereographic projection can be seen as a transformation that maps a sphere into a sphere, a spherical surface into the sphere. Now, if you consider the physical case that now we are studying, what we are doing? We are considering gauge group transformation. So these are the gauge transformation on the boundary of our four-dimensional Euclidean spacetime. This is what we are studying. So the boundary of our Euclidean R4 is S3. If you consider the gauge transformation, for example, the simplest non-abelian gauge transformation, what is SU2? SU2 is isomorphic to a sphere transformation. So you can look at the gauge transformation as maps from the boundary of R4, which is the trisphere, into an element of SU2, which is again a trisphere. And you can find some maps that goes from S3 to S3. And look at gauge transformation of this type. Now, this map, we've introduced a concept which is useful to classify this type of mass using the language of what is called homotopy group. Homotopy group, what they do? They classify, they count the number of non-equivalent maps that goes from a generic boundary Sn to a manifold M. And so we call the group of these maps as pi n m. That is the group of non-equivalent maps that goes from Sn to M. Okay. Let's consider a simple example now. in which the manifold M is SM. So we consider group maps that goes that go from SN to SM. N and M indicates the dimension of the sphere that you are considering. For example, the simplest case is S1. S1, what is? A circle, exactly, the circle. So now let's consider maps that goes from S1 to S1. So homotopy group is pi 1 S1. And I will show you different examples just to understand which is the, let's say, mysterious concept of a homotopy group. Let's consider the first map we call lambda 0 of theta. 0. What does this map? So it maps the circle into a point. Okay, 0. The second map I call lambda primo 0 of theta. That is t theta for 0 less than theta less than pi, and t to pi minus theta and t in. So what does this? You have the map, you have the circle, you start from 0 to theta and you get this t theta. But then when you go at theta larger than pi, you come back. So the map essentially does something like this at the for different value of theta. Now, these maps, if you look, let's say, superficially, they can see different type of maps, because one is a point, the other is this region. But if you consider them from the point of view of the topology, they are essentially belong to the same class. And I can show this simply. Because if you vary the parameter t of the second map, you can continuously deform the second map into the first. So you can shrink the second to a point, choosing a smaller and smaller value of t. So they belong to what is called the same class of homotopy, because they can be continuously deformed from one to the other one. Well, if you consider now as next map pi 1 of theta equal theta, these maps the circle into a circle. And now this map cannot be deformed to the first class because it cannot be shrink to a point, right? Now, in order to classify these different maps, one introduces a concept, a number that is called the winding number. That we can call Q tilde, that is 1 over 2 pi integral between 0 and 2 pi in the lambda in the theta, the theta. And you can simply see that in the first two cases, Q is 0, while in the case for example, in this last one, Q is 1. In general, you can have, if you consider maps of this type, what they are, these maps? They map, they wrap n times the circle around itself. And so in this case, the topological winding number is n. In principle, you can also put a sign depending if you want to make your circuit in the clockwise or anti-clockwise direction. So this is the winding number. Now, if we want now this homotopy group, we said that it counts the number of inequivalent maps around the circle. So which is this pi in this case? Which is the number of these maps? No, I said that if I have that map that go n time around the circle, they are different from. So which is the number of inequivalent maps? Sorry? It's Z. Because you have all the natural plus countervise and anti-countervise. Okay. This is the homotopy group for S1. In general, what you can show is that if you consider pi n as n, so the number of inequivalent maps from Sn to Sn, this is Z. Now, in our case, in which we said we are looking at inequivalent maps that go from the boundary of R4, so from S3, to the non-abelian group SU2, this, as said, is S3 to S3, because SU2 corresponds to a transformation on the sphere, which is this number, is again Z. So these are the number of non-equivalent maps that you can construct for your gauge field theory. Maps from the boundary of the Euclidean spacetime R4 from S3 to the group transformation SU2. And so these maps are different from the infinitesimal transformation, from the trivial mapping that comes from the infinitesimal transformation. And you can construct, for example, omega 1, the first one that is different from omega zero, that is the one that we built before. And the following ones can be obtained as omega one to the power of n. Now, since these still are transformation that can be diagonalized together with the Hamiltonian, they should be unitary transformation and are characterized being unitary transformation can be written, as if you remember, in this form. And omega n of x and so what you get is that you find a new parameter theta that is a Lorentz invariant, and this is called instanton angle. That becomes a new fundamental parameter of your theory. So what you can do, you can have a gauge transformation, and from this gauge transformation, you can start from a vacuum and construct n different vacua that are all connected through gauge transformation. This is what I'm doing now, okay? Now, the point is that if you consider this gauge transformation characterized by different winding numbers, they act on the space of our field, which is in any case a trivial space topologically. So there are no gaps, no holes in your space of the fields. Now let's consider a transformation that goes from your field AI to AI lambda X, where I write schematically that for the parameter lambda equal one, I get the new vacuum. So this is, I wrote schematically what I wrote at beginning as the effect of a gauge transformation. So lambda omega minus one, the mu plus I over one over G, the mu. And so this is, for parameter lambda equal one, you start from a vacuum and you build through the gauge transformation another vacuum. But if you consider lambda fractional, so not for the extreme, but in the range between zero and one, this is not a gauge transformation. And so what you get is that you get different field in the middle. And their expectation value can be written in this way, but graphically what happens? That if you consider this line of lambda parameter, lambda equal zero, lambda equal one, what you get is that for lambda equal zero and lambda equal one, you obtain a vacuum. However, what happens is that for the other value, intermediate value, this is not vacuum, so the energy should be larger. And so now what you get? You construct two vacua which are separated in this way, but you can now have tunnel between these vacua because these are connected by the gauge transformation. This is what you do in gauge theory, that is in general not allowed for field theory. You can connect these two vacua because you have a gauge transformation that allows to pass from one to the other one. So you don't have to cross infinite potential barrier because these fields, these states are connected by a gauge transformation. And so now what we search is, as we said, finite action configuration at infinity. So we have on the boundary of our Euclidean spacetime, the boundary is S3. On the sphere, you should have that the field, in order to have finite action, F should scale as R to minus 3. And so this implies F mu is the mu anu, so that A scales as R2 minus 2. So we are tempted, in order to have finite action on the boundary, to set simply This is the simplest thing that you can assume in order to have finite action. However, the point is that you have to keep in mind that you are working with a gauge theory. So this statement is not a gauge invariant consideration. Why? Because even if you start from this, as we said before, when you apply a gauge transformation, a mu is transformed over the mu, 1 over ig the mu plus a mu omega minus 1. So even if you assume that a mu is 0, after a gauge transformation, what you get? You get this configuration. So you don't have 0, you have the gauge transformation of 0, that is not 0. And so what you get is that you have to assume that the boundary field, in order to write a gauge invariant statement, you should not impose that this is 0, but that it is the gauge transformation of 0. So you have to impose that it is minus 1 over g omega, or omega minus 1 is the same, the mu omega. This is what you have to assume. And this configuration is called the pure gauge configuration. Because, I mean, what I said is that you are looking for instanton, so for finite action configuration. In order to have a finite action, the simplest thing is that since the field should decline as R to minus 2 at infinity, simply you would say it's 0. But then you exactly, that it is a gauge field theory, so it should be the not 0, but the gauge transformation of 0 in general, okay? This is the way in which you... So you have to impose this on the boundary. And then now, if we consider, for example, a gauge group, SU2, we said that we can have Z different maps. And so this will be Z, the instanton number. Now, a question. Why we cannot... I assume that I started my discussion saying that we are working with the non-abelian gauge theory, okay? So why we don't work with the abelian gauge theory? So for example, for U1, if we consider what is this? How can you imagine this? I have a sphere, and my transformation now are a circle on a sphere. You can contract all the circle to a point. So you don't have non-equivalent maps if you consider as boundary S3. You have, that's the reason why you have to work with the non-abelian case. So the simplest is SU2. And since all other non-abelian gauge group contains SU2 as a subgroup, this is the simplest case that you can consider. It's clear for everybody. So when we look for instanton, we have to look for non-abelian case, okay? In U1, there is no finite action configuration. We don't have instanton in electromagnetism. And so now we can come back to the winding number after having introduced the gauge transformation. Because we can write another definition of the winding number that now will be useful for us. So here we introduced essentially let's start now from U1, which is the simplest case, and then generalize to the non-abelian one. So the map on the circle, we said that we can write as theta, that is n alpha plus beta, and n, the winding number, is 1 over 2 pi . However, we can, using the group element, we can write this transformation as U alpha, that is N alpha plus beta. And so you can define the winning number in this case as minus I over 2 pi, integral between 0 and 2 pi, U minus 1. In the alpha, U in the alpha is the same, okay? Yeah. This is the exponential form, no? Of the group transformation. Now, the idea is that we can use this definition and generalize it to the case of non-abelian. So, if you understand this, you can understand at least the writing of the non-abelian case. Because it is, to write this is more complicated, but the meaning is this one. So in the case of non-abelian, if we call omega the group transformation, n, the winding number, is defined as minus 1 over 24 pi over 2, d3. Theta, epsilon ijk, trace omega minus 1, di omega. And since we have three angles on the boundary, this is omega minus 1, dj theta, times omega minus 1, dk. So this is the generalization of the winning number from the non-abelian case. The structure you see is the same of the abelian case. It's just that you have to consider that on the boundary of SU2, you have three angles to map the three sphere, right? Now, this factor in front simply comes from the Jacobian of the transformation. So in order to have a natural number, you have to divide by this. However, you can, I canceled, but you have written, okay, it's written there. Since on the boundary you define the gauge field in this way, we can write the winding number in the same way as I, g square over 24 pi over 2, the trace of epsilon I jk AI n AJ n AK n. And this is called Pontryagin index. You see, I'm simply using the definition of the omega transformation in terms of the gauge field on the boundary, okay? Now the next step is to introduce what is called the Chern-Simons current that is a vector defined in this way, k mu equal epsilon mu alpha beta gamma A alpha. The index in Latin letters are the group index. These are the Lorentz index, the Greek letters. And this satisfies the mu, k mu equal f a mu nu f tilde mu nu a, where this field with the tilde is called the dual that is obtained as epsilon mu nu alpha beta F alpha beta, okay, the dual field. And one finds, now why introduce? Because it's linked with the wind number. As chi0 equal minus g over 3 epsilon I j k epsilon a b c a I a j b a k c, and this is equal to 4/3 I g epsilon I j k trace of a I a j a k. And so I can write now the winding number as g square over 32 pi square. You see this definition is the one that enters the winding number. Hmm? So I can write this in general as k mu the sigma mu, where sigma mu is a surface. And using the Gauss theorem, this is g square over 32 b square, the mu k mu over the 4x. And now I use that the divergence of this object is this one. So this gives g square over 32 pi over 2 f a mu nu f tilde a mu nu the 4x. And if I want to use not the components but the field, I get g square over 16 pi over 2 integral in the 4x of the trace of f mu nu f tilde mu nu. Now, okay. Of the, yeah, right. The one that appears in the winning number. And now what I get is that I can write the Euclidean action, the one from which I started, as 1/4, therefore x. I omit the indices just to be shorter. FF tilde plus 1/2 f minus f tilde square. Why am I writing this way? Because the first part is the one related to the instanton number, FF tilde, you see. And so I write here 8 pi square n over g square plus 1/8 therefore x f minus f tilde square. And so what I get, so this is positive, so I get that the Euclidean action is greater or equal than 8 pi square n over g square. And so I have a transition amplitude given by this. This is the instanton in the gauge theory, this action. You see that this is a non-perturbative effect. Why? Because the coupling is at the denominator. So if you have a small g, you have a large effect. So it's not something that comes from the expansion of Feynman diagram, okay? And so this is a good point to stop. The next things that we will see tomorrow is how to tunnel from the different vacua. So what we understood today is that in quantum mechanics, in classical mechanics, we have spontaneous symmetry breaking. In quantum mechanics, we have the tunnel effect. When we go in quantum field theory in general, we cannot have tunnel because infinite barrier of potential between the vacua. So we have to go to non-abelian gauge theory, where we have the possibility to build different infinite vacua, which are characterized by topological gauge transformation characterized by winding number. And so now what we want to understand is how to tunnel among the different vacua, as we have seen at the beginning in quantum mechanics. Okay. For questions. Can you also tell your name just so we try to know each other better? Sphalerons are another type of non-perturbative effect. Honestly, I don't remember exactly the definition, but instantons are more similar, if you want to understand something, to the solitons, if you have some idea of quantum field, in quantum field theory. I mean, typically when you do Feynman expansion, now you do the expansion. So you have, in terms of power of coupling, right? G square, and the next order term should be smaller in order to have a convergent series. Now what you see is that here the effect is inverse of the coupling. So it's not something that you cover in the expansion of the Feynman rule, because the expansion is not in the inverse coupling. That is what we will see, the chiral Lagrange, the next time. So we will see that this is related to the chiral Lagrange, so to another problem which is called the U, probably this is what you know, the U1 axial problem of the QCD in the chiral limit. Is the same that you, for example, you obtain when you talk about fractional charge, the Chern-Simons current, J mu, is the similar definition, yeah. Of these of these slides where there is some yeah some of the yeah in any case I mean most of the calculation you can find also in the references in the first